Welcome to the seventh in a series of 14 talks designed to introduce you to the God who is there. My name is Don Carson, and we're trying to work through some of the Bible's sweeping themes. Today, I shall briefly tackle two more. The God who is coming is simply a way of getting at the fact that the Old Testament, the part that takes us up to the period just before Jesus, finds many ways to look forward to a visitation from God Himself, a visitation that will change everything. This trajectory of expectation, waiting for God to come, rushes forward until it bursts into the second theme, the theme that Christians call the incarnation, the God who becomes a human being. When you take the time to reflect deeply on what the Bible says about this event, you are likely to respond in one of two ways. You may judge these claims so bizarre or so intrusive into your life that you decide to walk away. Or you may judge these claims bizarre, yes, yet spectacularly wonderful, drawing us on to look at Jesus with eyes of wonder and hearts full of frank adoration. Only those whose emotions and thought have atrophied are likely to remain entirely unmoved. This is the seventh in the series. Well, we have finally come to the New Testament. You knew that we would get there if you waited long enough. So I hope that you will open your Bibles in the next few moments to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. This talk has the rather, frankly, amazing theme, the God who becomes a human being. It presupposes that this God keeps telling us that He's coming. In one sense, He comes to Abraham and calls him on his pilgrimage. He comes to Moses and gives him a certain task. He comes to David and establishes a dynasty. In the Old Testament, through large numbers of the books of the prophets that I've alluded to, but we haven't really looked closely to any one of them, God is repeatedly said to come. He sometimes comes with judgment. People speak of the day of the Lord, the time when the Lord comes, the day of the Lord. Oh, it'll be wonderful when the Lord comes. And God says, no, when I come, the day of the Lord is going to be full of darkness, not light. There's going to be judgment. So sometimes God comes not only upon His covenant people with judgment, but the God of the Bible is the God of all the nations. So He holds all the nations to account. Righteousness exalts a people, but sin is a reproach to any people in the Bible. So God promises to come and visit the Babylonians with judgment, or the pagan cities of Tyre and Sidon with judgment, and so forth. And He also comes to His own covenant people with judgment. But He also keeps promising to come with forgiveness, with the ultimate Davidic king, with transformation. We saw one of those passages briefly in the prophecy of Isaiah, chapter 9, words that we're familiar with from Handel's Messiah, from nowhere else, when ultimately there is a king coming who will reign on David's throne. The increase of His kingdom will never end, and He'll also be called the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. Then there are other passages where you get this anticipation of someone who comes who is God. God is coming. And yet He's tied somehow to this Davidic figure. One of the most remarkable passages in this respect is by another prophet, the prophet Ezekiel. In Ezekiel chapter 34, the prophet Ezekiel, who's writing at the beginning of the 6th century BC, the word of the Lord came to me, "Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel." Now, that does not mean the people who keep the sheep, literally, but the rulers, the nobles, the monarchs as they come and go, the leaders, the priests. "Prophesy against the shepherds of Israel, who only take care of yourselves. Woe to you, shepherds of Israel, who only take care of yourselves. Should not shepherds take care of the flock? You eat the curds, clothe yourselves with wool, and slaughter the choice animals, but you do not take care of the flock.
You have not strengthened the weak, or healed the sick, or bound up the injured. You have not brought back the strays, or searched for the lost. You have ruled them harshly and brutally. So they were scattered because there was no shepherd. My sheep wandered over all the mountains and on every high hill. They were scattered over the whole earth, and no one searched or looked for them. And then what God says, in many different ways, through verse after verse after verse, is this: I will not only judge the false shepherds, I will become the shepherd of my people. This is what the sovereign Lord says, verse 10. I am against the shepherds and will hold them accountable. I will remove them from tending the flock. And then he goes on to say, verse 12, as shepherds look after their scattered flocks when they are with them, so will I look after my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places where they were scattered on a day of clouds and darkness. I will bring them out from the nations and gather them from the countries. I will bring them into their own land. I will pasture them on the mountains of Israel. I will tend them in good pasture. I myself will tend my sheep. I will have them lie down, declares the sovereign Lord. I will search for the lost. I will bring back the strays. In other words, all these false shepherds are just ruining the flock. I myself will be their shepherd. And then after saying this again and again and again, about 25 times, God himself is going to shepherd his people. He's going to come. He's going to do the job himself. He then says, verse 23, I will place over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he will tend them. He will tend them and be their shepherd. I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David will be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. So somehow this promise of God himself coming and a Davidic king coming get merged into one. So when we come to the New Testament, the four first books of the New Testament are often called Gospels: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all begin a little differently, but they all begin in some way with the coming of Jesus. Before him, there is always mention of John the Baptist, who points out who Jesus is. And then Luke's gospel, for example, depicts an angelic visitation to Mary, promising her a virginal conception, a miraculous thing, such that the child born in her would be called the Son of God. And then in chapter 2 of that book, the familiar Christmas story. In Matthew's gospel, the thing is looked at less from Mary's perspective and more from Jesus' perspective, and more from Joseph's perspective. Mary was betrothed to Joseph, and then he discovers she's got pregnant. Don't forget that in that society, they couldn't go off somewhere in the corner and have a little chit-chat, and she could try and convince him it was a miracle. You didn't have that kind of easy, free conversation. There were chaperones and guardians around all the time. But God visited Joseph as well and insisted that this was his doing. She was a virgin. And Joseph, when the baby came, was to give the baby the name Jesus. Jesus is simply the Greek form of Joshua. And Joshua means Yahweh saves. That is the name of God in the Old Testament, connected to I am who I am. God saves. And you are to give this baby the name Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. That's already in the first chapter of Matthew, chapter 1, verse 21. Which means, in a sense, the whole rest of the book of Matthew, the first gospel, is to be read as the gospel in which Yahweh saves his people from their sins. That's what Jesus does. Every chapter of that book can be fed under that theme. John's gospel begins a slightly different way. It does not begin with the historical developments, Joseph and Mary and Bethlehem and the visit of the shepherds, things like that. It begins by thinking about the coming of the eternal Son, the coming of God in theological terms. Let me read the first 18 verses, sometimes called John's prologue. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified concerning him. He cried out, saying, "This is he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' Out of his fullness we have all received grace, in place of grace already given. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known." Let me run through the thought of this very quickly. First, you cannot help but see that this one who's coming is simply called the Word. In the beginning was the Word. We might say, in the beginning was God's self-expression. In the beginning, God expressed himself. In the beginning was God's self-expression, and this self-expression was with God, God's own fellow. And this self-expression was God, God's own self. And already your heart begins to flutter and your mind wonders, what's going on here? How do you think in those terms? But that's what the text says. This one who becomes flesh, who takes on human identity, is one with God, God's own agent in creation, God's own self. Even the term Word is an interesting choice, isn't it? How do you think about how do you think about Jesus? What title is adequate for him? I can imagine in John's head going round and round various titles and names and expressions that could be used. And he remembers, for example, that in the Old Testament, we read again and again, the word of the Lord came to the prophet saying, so God has disclosed himself in revelation. Or he remembers John 1, God spoke and something came into being. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. God's word in creation. Even God's word in saving people, transforming people. God sent forth his word and he healed them, quoting from the Psalms. All these things that God's Word accomplishes, he reveals, he creates, he transforms, and he thinks, yes, that's the appropriate expression that summarizes all who Jesus is. He's God's self-expression. He is there with God in the beginning. God is one, and yet there is a complexity in him from the very beginning. This Word is God's own fellow, and he's God's own self. And then what is predicated of him? Well, first, he's God's own agent in creation. Through him, verse 3, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. That's the way the book begins. But then we're also told that the Word gives us light and life. You know, some books you only read once. You have a trip, let's say, to L.A., and you pick up a whodunit, in the bookshop in the airport, and by the time you get to LA, you found out who done it. And you decide this is not a book you're going to keep in your library, so you put it in the seat pocket in front of you, and the cleaners take it out, and you'll never read it again. In fact, it's even possible 6 months from now, when you make another busy trip to LA, you'll buy the same flipping book and read it again, because you won't remember how it went. It's possible. But there are other books where you read them more than once, don't you? There are books you like to pore over, the quality of the English prose. It might even be a whodunit, but it's got the atmosphere exactly right, or it describes a part of the world where you live, and you enjoy thinking about it. You read it once for the plot, then you read it for the characterization, then you read it again for all the little touches and nuances. You get a real kick out of it. Now the question is, did John write his book as a throwaway tract to be read once, or is it the sort of book where he wanted it to be read again and again and again? I think you can show that he read it, he wrote it in such a way that he expected you to see new things from it as you keep rereading it. If you read verses 4 and 5 without ever having read the rest of the book, all you've read so far is verses 1, 2, and 3, how will you understand 4 and 5? Verse 3, through him all things were made, without him nothing was made that has been made. You're talking about creation. In him was life, and that life was the light of all people. That is, he had life in himself, and he gave life to all human beings. That was their light. There was darkness, and then there was light. The line shines in the darkness, the darkness of nothingness, before he came along and created everything. In other words, you can understand verses 4 and 5 entirely with respect to verses 3 and 4. And I suspect if you were reading it through the first time, that's the way you'd understand it. And then you read 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. And you start seeing how light has now got overtones, not of physical light and the nothingness that existed before the creation. Now light has some sort of overtone of revelation or truth or something, light that is revealed. And the same sort of moral or revelatory overtone is clearer and clearer as the book goes on. Thus we read, for example, a little farther on in the book, that men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. People choose the darkness because they're afraid to come to the light. 3:20, all those who do evil hate the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. Those who live by the truth come into the light. You see, in this kind of context, light is not the light of creation. It's the light of revelation. It's the light of truth. And now you go back and reread verses 4 and 5 in the light of all of this. By the time you get to John chapter 8, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. In him was life. That life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness of moral corruption and rebellion, and the darkness has not overcome it. Now you have another set of overtones, do you see? And you ask, which is true? Jesus as the agent of physical light and life and creation, or Jesus as the one who brings revelation and transformation and overcoming moral darkness? And the answer, of course, is yes. Because you're supposed to read it both ways. It's the way the book has been written. You read it and reread it and see more and more connections. The light gives us light and life. Then we're told, verses 10 to 13, that the word confronts us and divides us. Verse 10. He was in the world, that is the world that he had made, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own home, his own people. His own people did not receive him. People did not look on Jesus and say, ah, you're finally here, the light of the world. Many were puzzled by him. Some were repulsed by him. Because even if they did see the light, they were ashamed in his presence and preferred the darkness to the light. And so his very coming did not guarantee a universal revival, everybody turning to him. Some did receive him. They believed in his name, we're told, verse 12. And to them he gave the right to become children of God, Children born not of natural descent, it's not just natural children that are in view, or of a human decision from sexual intercourse, or a husband's will, assuming he's taking some sort of primary role in the conception. No, 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 no. These people are not simply humanly born. They're born of God. Now, that's a theme we'll come back to next week. That is, they are different because God has done something new in them. There is a new creation. There is a new birth. He's starting something over in them, and they truly believe who Jesus really is. And then, verses 14 to 18, with this we close. You may recall that earlier this morning, we looked at the remarkable passage rather briefly, Exodus 32, 33, 34, where Moses comes down from the mountain, and the people are in an orgy of idolatry. And Moses prays before God and wants to see more of God's glory. Show me your glory. And God says, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, but you cannot see my face and live. There are six major themes in those verses that are picked up here in these verses. You know how when you're dealing with a community that knows a book or a film, you just quote one line and the whole scene comes back to mind? My son, for whatever reason, has a formidable memory when it comes to movies. And so you simply drop in one line and he'll tell you the whole scene. Or you say, you remember the third film in the Star Wars series where something or other happens? He'll quote the whole thing. He's got this formidable mind for audio-visual recall. What could I say? I don't have it. For people steeped in the Bible, as many as the first readers were, if you read through these verses together, your mind is going to go back to Exodus 32, 33, 34. Let me show you, and we're done. The Word became flesh. The Word became a human being. That's what it means. This Word became something that He wasn't. He already existed. He was God's own agent in creation, but now He becomes a human being and made His dwelling among us. Now, the expression is quite literally, He tabernacled among us. He tabernacled among us. And for anybody with an Old Testament background, you can't help but remember that the tabernacle was what God set up at the time of Sinai. A tabernacle with this special most holy room where only the high priest could go in on behalf of everybody else once a year with the blood of the sacrifices. It was the place where sinners met God. It was the great meeting place between a holy God and sinners, provided for by this blood of the bull and the goat that was brought in by the high priest. It was the great meeting place between God and human beings. And eventually, it's the temple that replaces it. And now in this chapter, we're told, the Word became flesh and He tabernacled among us. And in the very next chapter, chapter 2, Jesus insists that He Himself is the temple of God. That is, Jesus insists that He becomes the great meeting place between rebels and this holy God. If rebels are going to be reconciled to this God, they've got to come through the temple. And I'm the temple. Much of John's gospel explains how that's so. Look what else is here. The Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. He tabernacled among us. We have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. We have seen His glory? What was it that Moses asked for? Show me your glory! And God said, I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. Now, John plays with this theme of glory right through his book. In chapter 2, for example, when Jesus performs His first miracle, turns water into wine at the marriage in Cana of Galilee, we're told at the end of it that the disciples saw His glory. The others saw the miracle. They saw that it was saying something about who Jesus was. They saw His glory. And then eventually you get to John chapter 12, where Jesus is to manifest God's glory by going to the cross. Where is God's glory most manifested? When Jesus is glorified, lifted up, and displays God's glory in the shame and ignominy and brutality and sacrifice of a cross. When we think of God's glory, we think maybe of some spectacular visionary scene with the Chicago Symphony playing along with the Boston Symphony, and presumably there's one here in Minneapolis joining in together, and maybe a great choir of voices and spectacular array of lightning and thunder in the background. Glory! Maybe it's a supernova that you see through a telescope. But the most spectacular display of God's glory is in a bloody instrument of torture. Because you see, that's where God's goodness was most displayed. Oh, it's nice to sing the Hallelujah chorus. But you also have to sing, "On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame." Because there God displayed his glory in Christ Jesus, who thus became our tabernacle, our temple, the meeting place between God and human beings. Do you see the end of this verse? "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." When God intones who he is before Moses in that cave in Exodus 34, he describes himself in a variety of ways. Included among them are, he is full of, the words are hard to translate, full of love and faithfulness. In Hebrew, they're the same words for grace and truth. God displays himself not only as the God who will punish sinners, but he's full of grace and truth and forgives. And now John, reflecting on who Jesus is, who manifests God's goodness, his glory in the cross, he says he was full of grace and truth. The grace and truth that brought him to the cross and paid for our sins. Indeed, John bore witness to him, John the Baptist, all the biblical writers tell us that the forerunner announced who Jesus was before Jesus came. And then he adds, "Out of his fullness, out of the fullness of Jesus, we have all received grace in place of grace already given." That's exactly what is meant. We had received a grace, now we've got a grace that's substituted for it. It doesn't mean grace on top of grace, merely added up like presents around the Christmas tree, piled up one on top of another, blessing after blessing. That's not what is meant. We have all received a grace in place of a grace already given. What does that mean? Well, the next verse tells us, "For the law was given through Moses." That's taking you back to Exodus 32, 33, 34. The law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. In other words, the gift of the law was a gracious thing. It was a wonderful thing. It was a gracious gift that God gave to his people as he brought them along the pilgrim way in preparation for who Jesus was. But grace and truth par excellence, that came through Jesus Christ. Not in the display of glory to Moses in a cave, in the display of Jesus in a bloody sacrifice on a cross. The law covenant was a gracious gift from God. But now Jesus is going to introduce a new covenant, ultimately grace and truth. This is a grace that replaces that old grace. It's a new covenant. In fact, it's more than that. No one has ever seen God. Isn't that what God said in Exodus 33? No one can look on my face and live. But the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, has made him known. Do you hear what this text is saying? Do you want to know what God looks like? Look at Jesus. No one has seen God. And God in all of his transcendent splendor, we still cannot see until the last day. But the Word became flesh. God became a human being. That's why later in this book, just before Jesus goes to the cross, he says to his own disciples, Have I been with you all this time, and yet have you not known me? He who has seen me has seen the Father. Do you want to know what the character of God is like? Study Jesus. Do you want to know what the holiness of God is like? Study Jesus. Do you want to know what the wrath of God is like? Study Jesus. Do you want to know what the forgiveness of God is like? Study Jesus. Do you want to know what the glory of God is like? Study Jesus. All the way to that execrable cross. Study Jesus. May I tell you a concluding story? It's an old story now. My first degree was in chemistry and mathematics at McGill University in Montreal, a long time ago now. And somewhere along the line, I befriended a wonderful Pakistani gentleman. He was twice as old as I was. He had come to McGill to do a PhD in Islamic studies. McGill had a very fine Islamic institute at the time. And he had left his wife and two children behind in Pakistan. And so he was lonely, and somewhere along the line, we were in a men's dorm, and I befriended him. And it dawned on me after a while that he was trying to convert me to Islam. I was a bit thick, but eventually I realized that's what he was trying to do, so I thought maybe I should return the favor. Except that he was a trained Muslim theologian, and I was studying chemistry, you know? I remember walking down the hill one night on Pine Avenue. He had agreed to come to church with me. He wanted to see what it was like. And he said to me, "Don, you study mathematics, yes?" "Yes." "If you have one cup and then you add another cup, how many cups do you have?" "Well, I studied mathematics, so I said two." "If you have two cups and you add another cup, how many cups do you have left?" "I said, three." "If you have three cups and you take away one cup, how many cups do you have?" "I said, two." So far, I was hitting on all cylinders. So he says, "You believe that the Father is God?" "Yes." Uh-oh, I could see where this was going. "You believe that Jesus is God?" "Yes." "You believe that the Son is, that the Holy Spirit is God?" "Yes." "So if you have one God plus one God plus one God, how many gods do you have?" I was studying chemistry. How was I supposed to answer that? The best I could do was, "Listen, if you're going to use a mathematical model, then let me choose the branch of mathematics. Let's talk about infinities. Infinity plus infinity plus infinity equals infinity. I serve an infinite God." Well, he laughed. He thought that was a great joke. And that was the level of our friendship, but we weren't getting anywhere. Suddenly it dawned on me about November that he had never read the Christian Bible. He didn't own one. He had never held one in his hand, so I went and bought him one. I brought him a Christian Bible. He said, "Where do I start?" He didn't know how it was put together. He didn't know about Old Testament and New Testament. He didn't know about the Gospels. He didn't know about Moses and where he fit in the whole thing. He had heard all of these names, of course, from the Quran, but he didn't know how the Bible worked. And I didn't know what to suggest to him. So I said, "Well, why don't you start with John's Gospel?" So I showed him where it was, and Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John start with John's Gospel. But of course, coming as he did from Asia, he didn't read books the way I would read a book. You know, how many pages can I get through tonight? The more, the better. No, he had a different style of reading where you'd read something, and then you'd stop, and you'd think about it, and turn it over in your head, go back and reread it. He was meditating. He was reflecting. He was thinking about it. He didn't stop and ask me any questions. He just read quietly. That Christmas, I brought him home to my parents, who at that point lived on the French side of our capital city, Ottawa, in a place called Hull. And it transpired that my father had heart problems, and my mother and I spent most of our time in the hospital, and my dear friend Muhammad Yusuf was left largely on his own. By the end of that Christmas break, it turned out that Dad was fine, and so I asked to borrow the car. We only had the one. So I could take to take Muhammad Yusuf to see some of the sites in the capital city. And we went here and there, and eventually we went to our parliament buildings. And in those days, there was much less security than there is now. We got on one of these guide tours, 30 of us being brought around to the rotunda at the back where the library is, and the Senate chambers, and the House of Commons, and the rogues gallery of Canadian prime ministers from Sir John A. Macdonald and so forth. And all of these comments that filled in a bit of Canadian history, we listened. We got back to the central foyer, and there are these huge pillars. And at the top of each pillar is a little fresco where there is a figure. And the guide explained, there is Aristotle, for government must be based on knowledge. There is Socrates, for government must be based on wisdom. There is Moses, for government must be based on law. He went all the way around. Then he said, any questions? My friend piped up, where is Jesus Christ? The guy did what guides do under such circumstances. They simply say, I beg your pardon? So Muhammad did what foreigners do under such circumstances. They assume that they've been misunderstood because of their thick accent. So he said it more clearly and more loudly, where is Jesus Christ? And now there were three groups in the foyer of the Canadian Parliament listening to a Pakistani Muslim ask where Jesus was. I was looking for a crack in the ground to fall into. I had no idea where this was coming from. Finally, the guide blurted out, but why should Jesus be here? Muhammad looked shocked. He said, I read in the Christian Bible that the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Where is Jesus Christ? The guide said, I don't know anything about that. And I muttered under my breath, preach it, brother. Did you see how it looked to Muhammad's point of view? He was a Muslim. He understood about a God who has laws, who has standards, who brings terror, who sits in judgment over you. A God who is sovereign and holy and powerful. He understood all of that. But he had already been captured by Jesus, full of grace and truth, who displays his glory profoundly in the cross and becomes the meeting place between God and sinners because he dies a sinner's death. Let us pray. Lord, you know all of our hearts and minds as we sit here quietly. Some of us have been believers for a long time, but we've sneakily begun to cherish sin again, and we are ashamed. Help us to see that when we sin, you are always the most offended party. But that our hope too is in you and the sacrifice you have provided in the person of your Son. We have no other hope. And for some gathered here, this, This is new, but it's wonderfully new. Help them to cry in the quietness of their own minds and hearts even now, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. For Jesus' sake. Amen.